Hello student, I am Professor A.V. Bramne. Today we will start our next article, that is article number 2 in unit number 1. In the previous article, we have seen the implicit parallelism, that is trends in microprocessor architecture. Under that we have seen how the pipelining is useful for parallelism. Multiple instruction pipelines are available on microprocessor architecture, and that helps to improve the processing power of microprocessor. Now, that type of processor is called as superscalar processor. That superscalar processor is having one of the disadvantage or one of the limitation of that superscalar execution is the hardware cost and the complexity of the superscalar scheduler is a major consideration in processor design. Now, how we can overcome this limitation? To address this issue, the VLIW processor rely on compile time analysis to identify and bundle together instruction that can be executed concurrently. So our today's article is VLIW processor, that is very large instruction word processor. So these processors are rely on compile time analysis to identify and bundle together instructions that can be executed concurrently. These instructions are packed and dispatched together, and thus the name very long instruction word. This concept was used with some commercial success in the multi-flow trace machine. Variant of this concept are employed in Intel IA64 processor. Now, what are the considerations of this VLIW processor? Issue hardware is simpler. Compiler has a bigger context from which to select co-schedule instruction. Compiler, however, do not have runtime information such as cache misses, scheduling ease, therefore inherently conservative. Branch and memory prediction is more difficult. VLIW performance is highly dependent on a compiler. The number of techniques such as loop unrolling, speculative execution, branch predictions are critical. Typical VLIW processors are limited to 4-way to 8-way parallelism. Now, previous two article like VLIW processor, or in a previous video we have seen the superscalar processor. These are the two processor. First one is related to the hardware, and VLIW processor is related to the compiler. Okay, as you have seen here, it mainly the compiler has a bigger context from which to select the co-scheduled instruction. So one of the drawback of superscalar processor, like a complex hardware and which cost more, that can be overcome by using this VLIW processor. Okay, but even though you can see here, VLIW performance is highly dependent on compiler. The number of techniques such as loop unrolling, speculative execution, branch predictions are critical. So this second last point of this slide is very important. VLIW processor is also having a limitation, is also having a challenges. And the challenges are loop unrolling, speculative execution, branch predictions are critical in VLIW processor. Now what to do? How to overcome this drawback? How to get the effective parallelism? That is our major point. So point is that in superscalar processor and in VLIW processor, the limitations are there. Now, in as a developer or as a engineer, what is in our hand, how we can overcome these issues? So in the next article, we will learn what are the areas that that degrade the performance of our system, that we will first of all focus. So limitation of memory system performance. Memory system and not the processor speed is often bottleneck for many applications. Memory system performance is largely captured by two parameters, that is latency and bandwidth. Latency is the time from the issue of memory request and to the time the data is available at the processor. I repeat, what is latency? Latency is the time from the issue of the memory request to the time the data is available at the processor. And what is bandwidth? Bandwidth is the rate at which the data can be pumped to the processor by the memory system. So it is very important to understand the difference between latency and bandwidth. Consider the example of fire hose. If the water comes out of the hose 2 seconds after the hydrant is turned on, the latency of the system is 2 seconds. Once the water starts flowing, if the hydrant delivers water at the rate of 5 gallons per second, the bandwidth of the system is 5 gallons per second. If you want to immediate response from the hydrant, it is important to reduce latency. And if you want to fight big fires, you want high bandwidth. So this example can give us the idea that what is meant by latency and bandwidth. These are the very two very important parameters that are related with memory system performance. Now, to understand the memory latency, example is given. So what is this example? See here. Consider a processor operating at 1 gigahertz, that is 1 nanosecond clock, connected to DRAM with latency of 100 nanosecond without catching. Assume that the processor has 2 multiply add unit and is capable of executing 4 instructions in each cycle of 1 nanosecond. The following observation follow. That is, the peak processor rating is 4 gigaflops. Since the memory latency is equal to 100 cycles, the block size is 1 word. Every time a memory request is made, the processor must wait 100 cycles before it can process the data. So this is one of the configuration of the processor that is given in this example. Now, on the above architecture, consider the problem of computing dot product of 2 vectors. A dot product computation performs 1 multiply add on a single pair of vector element. That is, each floating point operation requires 1 data fetch. It follows that a peak speed of this computation is limited to 1 floating point operation every 100 nanoseconds, or a speed of 10 megaflop, a very small fraction of the peak processor rating. Now, how to improve this performance of memory related to the latency? So that's why improving the effective memory latency using cache. Cache are small and fast memory elements between the processor and DRAM. This memory act as low latency and high bandwidth storage. If a piece of data is repeatedly used, the effective latency of this memory system can be reduced to cache. The fraction of data reference satisfied by the cache is called as cache hit ratio of the computation of the system. Cache hit ratio achieved by code on the memory system often determines its performance. Impact of cache. Consider the architecture from the previous example. In this case, we introduce a cache of size 32 kilobytes with latency 1 nanosecond or 1 cycle. We use this setup to multiply 2 matrices A and B of dimension 32 by 32. We have carefully chosen this number so that the cache is large enough to store the matrices A and B as well as the resultant matrix C. So, what is the impact of this adding cache? The following observation can be made out of the problem. Fetching 2 matrices into cache correspond to fetching 2 keywords, which takes approximately 200 microseconds. Multiplying 2n by n matrices takes 2^n³ operation. For our problem, this corresponds to 64k operations, which can be performed in 16k cycles or 16 microseconds at 4 instructions per cycle. The total time of the computation is therefore approximately the sum of the time for load or store operation and the time for the computational itself. that is 200 plus 16 microseconds. This corresponds to the peak computation rate of 64K by 216 or 303 megaflops. Repeated references to the same data atom correspond to the temporal locality. In our example, we had big O n square data access and big O n cube computation. This asymptotic difference makes the above example particularly desirable for cache. Data reuse is critical for cache performance. Now, impact of memory related to the bandwidth. Memory bandwidth is determined by bandwidth of the memory bus as well as the memory unit. Memory bandwidth can be improved by increasing the size of memory block. The underlying system takes L time unit, where L is the latency of the system to deliver B units of data, where B is the block size. Now again, to know or to learn the impact of memory bandwidth, let us see one example. Consider a same setup as before, except in this case, the block size is 4 words instead of 1 word. We repeat the dot product computation in this scenario. Assuming that the vectors are laid out linearly in memory, 8 flop, 4 multiply add can perform 200 cycles. This is because a single memory access fetches 4 consecutive words in the vector. Therefore, 2 access can fetch 4 elements of each of the vector. This corresponds to flop every 25 nanoseconds for the peak speed of 40 megaflop. It is important to note that increasing the block size does not change the latency of the system. Physically, the scenario illustrated here can be viewed as a wide data bus, 4 words or 128 bits, connected to multiple memory blanks. In practice, such wide bus are expensive to construct. In more practical system, consecutive words are sent to the memory bus on subsequent cycle after the first word is retrieved. The above example clearly illustrates how increased bandwidth result in higher speed computation rate. The data layouts were assumed to be such that consecutive data words in memory were used by successive instruction, that is, spatial locality of reference. If we take a data layout centric view, computation must be reordered to enhance spatial locality of reference. Now you can see one example like matrix multiplication or vector matrix dot product. So consider the code fragment where it is shown that for I is equal to 0, I less than 1000, I plus plus, column sum is equal to 0.0, and for j is equal to 0, j less than 1000, j plus plus, column sum equal to b equal b j I. The code fragment sum the column of the matrix B into vector column sum. Now, impact of the memory bandwidth example. The vector column sum is small and easily fits into cache. The matrix B is accessed in column order. The staggered access result in very poor performance. So that's why in this figure it is shown multiplying a matrix with vector in a first part, the multiplying column by column, keeping a running sum is shown. And in figure B, computing each element of the result as a dot product of row of the matrix with vector is shown. Now, we can fix the above code as shown here. So in this case, the matrix is traversed in row order and the performance can be expected to be significantly better. So what is shown in this example, like multiplying the matrix with vector column wise, or if we would be go for row measure access, then the performance of the matrix vector multiplication improves. That is a important part of this example. So in summary, what we learned in this article number 2, memory system performance, the series of examples presented in this section illustrate the following concept. Exploiting the spatial and the temporal locality in application is critical for amortizing memory latency and increasing effective memory bandwidth. The ratio of the number of operation to number of memory access is good indicator of anticipated tolerance to memory bandwidth. Memory layout and organizing computation appropriately can make a significant impact on spatial and temporal locality. So this is article number 2, where major focus is given on memory system performance. Now in article number 2, we learned that the pipelining and the superscalar processor, VLIW processor, they are used for implicit parallelism, but still there is a challenge, still there is a problem in getting the high performance. So how we can solve this problem? So in second article, we learned how to improve the memory system performance related to the latency and bandwidth. And again, catch-up plays the important role in improving the memory system performance. Similarly, we learned how to exploit the spatial and temporal locality in application. So this is the article number 2. In next article, we will see the next very important topic related to high performance computing system. Thank you.